vanavond in Lola de Musica een dubbelportret van Björk en PJ Harvey. Twee dames die weliswaar verschillen wat betreft muzikale invloeden, maar beide via het independent circuit uitgroeiden tot eigentijdse popdivas. Björk Gudmundsdóttir, 29 jaar, vroege zangeres van de Sugar Cubes, verruilde haar geboorteland IJsland voor Londen en begon daar 2 jaar geleden aan een zeer succesvolle solo-carrière. In 1993 verscheen van Björk de cd Debut, waarop ze dance met pop combineerde. Begin volgende maand komt haar nieuwe plaat uit, getiteld Post.
I was the first child of a mother and a father who had been in love since they were 14 years old. And I was born when my mother was 19, my father 20. And they were very conservative but happy sort of people. And then when my mother had been a housewife for 1 year with me, she freaked out and became a wild hippie and a feminist. And she separated with my father, and my father remained very conservative and married a nurse, but very hardworking, honest, very energetic man, and very full of power and joyful life. And my mother being completely just wanting to be a strong and painting all the walls with butterflies. And I live in a house with a lot of people who have long hair and listen to Jimi Hendrix. So I go between the two families and I learn, okay, maybe freedom isn't having long hair, and maybe discipline isn't suit, and not take anything for granted.
Polly Jean Harvey ontbond het trio waarmee ze eerder 2 cd's maakte en ging solo verder. Nog altijd onder de naam PJ Harvey. De nieuwste cd van de 25-jarige uit Engeland afkomstige PJ heet To Bring You My Love. En daarop klinkt ze toegankelijker, maar ook dramatischer dan ooit.
My parents are I've always been very encouraging to myself and my brother in whatever we wanted to do. But they're both very artistic and very interested in music. My father quarries stone, hamstone, and my mum sculpts in it, and she also does letter cutting for gravestones and house names and things like that. And they've just always had a huge love of music. It's so important to them. It was almost like a role reversal. My brother and I would be woken up at 3 in the morning with mum and dad putting on really loud music and couldn't sleep. But it's mostly, they're mostly interested in blues music and rhythm and blues. And Bob Dylan and the Stones. They were never Beatles fans, it was always the Stones.
And then I went to music school when I was 5 for 10 years, and they play me classical music all the time. My mother always played me hippie music. It's like guitar solos 24 hours in my house, like on 10. And my grandparents and my real father, they listened to a lot of jazz and Simon and Garfunkel and all this more sort of conservative music. And I enjoy all of them. I love all of them. And I like immediately to show the 3 different worlds, not to take granted for they have. So I go with Jimi Hendrix record to my grandparent and show them that maybe his solos weren't that far from jazz. And it's very nice. And then I take the jazz record to my music school and show them, or maybe, Miles Davis was related to Stravinsky. Maybe it's not a big difference between the two. And then I take classical music back to my parents. And I like very much to be the outside there and show, you know, ta-da! Life is not that simple. There's more to it than you think, sort of thing. Violently happy. Cause I love you. Violently happy. But you're not here. Violently happy. Over emotional. Violently happy. It'll get me into trouble real soon if you don't get here, baby.
I bought my first guitar when I was about 18, I think. I'd been playing saxophone since I was 11, so I already had quite a large interest in music and I could read music. I think it was just a musician friend of ours was selling an acoustic guitar, so I bought it. Well, I thought, well, this might be interesting. I could then be singing and playing an instrument at the same time.
Who taught you to play it?
I taught myself from chord books and from my favourite bands' called songbooks and things like that. And I remember I had a Bob Dylan songbook and a Police songbook, I think, was the ones I had.
Do you remember the first song you ever written on it?
Yes, unfortunately, yes.
Are you embarrassed about it?
Yes, extremely embarrassed.
What was it about?
Oh, I don't know. It was some girl on a journey, but it was done in a very young way. I mean, it's just very naive, very sweet. I wrote a lot of songs that will never see the light of day.
Dark you under deep salt water, bring me lover, all your power, I'll be no hell out of your spell, over, under, die of pleasure.
I usually write a song when I'm celebrating one thing or another. I tend to deal with my sad moments on my own and prefer to share the happy ones. And I don't think it's good or bad, it's just that people have different ways of dealing with different things. But I don't know, I like to, things, songs just happen. They just come all of a sudden and you just have to deal with them. They just pop up and you just don't relax. You go mad until you've finished them the way they're supposed to be.
Sometimes a song will just come through you. It really feels like that. And you've just got to be open enough to allow it to do that. And sometimes it'll need no shaping and it's just there within 5 minutes. And you kind of look back and think, where on earth did that come from? Because that wasn't, I hadn't been thinking of that at all. But it doesn't happen all the time. And a lot of the time, songs take months and months of really hard work and shaping, careful shaping, knocking bits out, putting the bits back, trying different bits in different places. Really, really hard work.
But at the end of the day, writing a song is like organizing an accident. That's very much what my job is about. To be kind of really organized and disciplined and kind of like get, yeah, 9 pianos. Yes, this piano has to be here and this piano has to be here. And I want 2 people to play this piano and 5 people to play this piano. And try to set it up like you're setting a trap in a forest for an animal. But of course, you don't know where the animal is going to run and what's going to happen. So you just got to sit back and make the animal go where it wants to go. And if it comes your way, just appreciate it and enjoy it.